Let's look at the following example. A company wants to invest $50 million into a new project. 80% will be raised through new equity. 20% will be raised through new debt. Flotation costs on equity are 10%. Flotation costs on debt are 5%. Two questions. What is the weighted average flotation cost? And what is the true investment needed for this new project? To answer the first question, we need to use the weighted average flotation cost formula. Because we're only raising money from two sources, equity and debt, there is no preferred stock part in the weighted average flotation cost formula. So we just have the weight of equity times the flotation cost of equity plus the weight of debt times the flotation cost of debt. Plugging in the numbers, we have 0.8 times 0.10 plus 0.2 times 0.05, which gives 0.09, or a 9% overall flotation cost. So whatever money we raise by selling common stock shares and bonds, 9% of that will be gone. It will be paid to some third party as a fee for helping us go through this process of issuing the new financial securities. Now let's answer the second question. What is the true investment that's needed? Using the formula from one of the earlier slides, we need to take $50 million, which is what the investment requires us to spend upfront, and divide it by 1 minus the weighted average flotation cost, 0.09. This gives $54.95 million. What if instead the proportions of money coming from new equity, new debt were not 80% and 20%, but equal proportions, 50% and 50%? Which part of our calculations for the two questions would be updated? Well, the weights come up in the calculation of the weighted average flotation cost. So where we had 0.8 and 0.2, we will now have 0.5 and 0.5. And that will change our weighted average flotation cost from 0.09 to 0.075. So because we will have less of the more expensive type of financing, the overall flotation cost will drop. And that's exactly what we see from our calculations. And then the new flotation cost will affect the true initial investment for our investment project. We will now divide 50 million by 1 minus 0.075, which will give us 54.05. So it won't cost us as much to start the new project when the financing of the flotation cost for the new financing of this project will become relatively cheaper. Let's look at the following example. A project requires $50 million in initial cost. So we're actually using the same numbers as on the previous slide. 80% will be raised from new equity and 20% will be raised from new bonds. The flotation cost for equity is 10%. The flotation cost for bonds is 5%, just like on the last slide. What else do we know? The investment project is expected to generate $32 million for 2 years. So it's a 2-year project. We also know that the pre-tax cost of debt to the firm is 8% per year, and the cost of equity to the firm is 14% per year. We also know that the company faces a corporate income tax rate of 34%. Is the project worth it? Let's calculate the project's net present value. Let's do it the wrong way and the correct way. The wrong way being ignoring flotation costs completely. Like, we don't know anything about them. We don't know what those are. And the right way will be with the flotation costs. The first step to calculating the project net present value is finding its discount rate. We're going to use the weighted average cost of capital formula for the discount rate. Of course, this assumes, by using the firm's WACC, we are assuming that So plugging in the numbers, the weight of equity is 0.8, the cost of equity is 0.14, the weight of debt is 0.2, the pre-tax cost of debt is 0.08, and we then multiply the pre-tax cost of debt by 1 minus 0.34. By the way, in some numerical problems, you're given the tax rate and you're given the after-tax cost of debt. This is a trick. If you are given the after-tax cost of debt, then you're given RD times 1 minus TC. So you don't need to then multiply it again by 1 minus TC, because that's already done in the number you're given for the after-tax cost of debt. So keep that in mind. Read the wording carefully. The weighted average cost of capital gives 0.12256. If we ignore the flotation costs, then we would then use the initial investment of $15 million for this project. If we do not ignore the flotation costs, we would realize that $15 million is not going to be the true cost of this project, because it needs to be kind of adjusted up for the flotation costs, the cost of raising money. The overall flotation cost, when the money comes from two sources, new equity and new bonds, will be calculated by taking the weight of equity, 0.8, just like the weight we used in the WACC formula. So notice how we use it two times for two different things. The weight of equity, 0.8, is then multiplied by the flotation cost of equity, which is given 10%. Or 0.1 in decimals. Then we add the weight of debt, 0.2, multiplied by the flotation cost of debt, 5%, or 0.05 in decimals, which gives us 0.09. So 9% of money that we raise will be paid to the third party helping us go through this issuing process, and what's left will be exactly 50 million that we need for the project. So how much extra do we need to raise to make up for the 9% flotation cost? That's calculating the true initial investment. 15 million that we need divided by 1 minus the overall flotation cost. 15 million divided by 1 minus 0.09 gives $54.95 million. So if we ignore the flotation costs, then the net present value would equal minus 15 million plus the first year's cash flow, $32 million, discounted using the WACC as the discount rate. So divided by 1 plus 0.12256. And then we add the second year's cash flow, another $32 million, discounted back by 2 years, using the WACC as the discount rate. So divided by 1 plus 0.12256 squared. And that would give us $3.9 million. And we would say that because the number is above zero, the project should be accepted. It's worth it. However, the mistake here is using $50 million for the initial investment. That's too little. The cost is actually higher when the flotation costs are considered. The true year zero cash flow is negative $54.95 million. And that will change the true net present value for our project to negative $1.05 million. Because it's negative, the correct decision regarding this project should be rejecting it. The project is not worth it. So you see how ignoring or not ignoring flotation costs may make a difference between accepting a project and rejecting it. So flotation costs are very important. Too high flotation costs may result in a too high initial investment, which will make the net present value negative. If we ignore flotation costs, we may mistakenly get a positive NPV. So we may mistakenly accept the project, which in fact should be rejected.